Radio 4. And now, to open this brand new series of Saturday Night Fry, we present a show that was first broadcast last December.
We'll just let it fade out after a while, and then I'll start speaking, OK? Yeah, well, I asked him to organise a private sale, in fact. Well, no, not unless they need the furniture as well. Yeah, OK. Right, so three seconds to air, then. Right. Good evening, and as the thunder and lightning polka fades away, it gives me enormous pleasure to welcome you, and many others too, I'm sure, to the very first Saturday Night Fry. Let me introduce myself. My name is Stephen Fry. I stand 6'4½ in my stocking feet, and I have a bent nose. I'm in my very late 20s. I enjoy weeding, collecting 17th-century Puritan tiaras, and dividing my time between Austrian Expressionist furniture. Now you know as much about me as I do myself. You'll forgive me for being formal, but then I like formality. Wasn't it Oscar Wilde who was imprisoned for sodomy? I don't know why I said that. I'm so sorry. Anyway, over the next few weeks, as part of a wider international government-funded experiment, I shall be presenting a series of short, half-hour radio programmes aimed at the psychosexually challenged members of the community. I'm obliged to tell you that it may be that some listeners will find parts of this programme rather badly written and incompetently performed. I hope not, but we shall see. But first, let's see what we can do about running the signature tune for you.
If you ever been down to New Orleans, then you can understand just what I mean. Now all through the week it's quiet as a mouse, but on Saturday night they go from house to house. You don't have to pay the usual admission if you're a cook or a waiter or a good musician. So if you happen to be just passing by, stop in at the Saturday Night Fish Fry. It was rockin'.
Well, there you are. That was the signature tune. Now, I have an impressive lineup of guests and a repertory company of two of the most talented actors working in England today. I thought it would be a good idea for you to meet them before we began. So, for this first programme, I managed to track them down and catch up with them at the place we arranged we would meet, the BBC Radio rehearsal rooms. Firstly, I said hello to Hugh Laurie.
Ma!
Yes.
Is that right?
Hugh, hello.
Good afternoon to you, Stephen.
Now, Hugh, tell us something about yourself, your work.
Stephen, I've worked extensively in both television.
Mm-hmm. What sort of characters are your speciality, would you say?
I like to work younger character actors. Rustics, passed-over majors, and embittered paediatricians.
I see. What about Shakespeare?
Never have played Shakespeare, funnily enough. I don't have the height, you see. Although I did once play Christopher Marlowe in a television special. I've been in dozens of Shakespeare plays, of course. A Midsummer Night's Dream, Merchant of Venice, even to some extent, Timon of Athens.
And comedy or tragedy, mostly?
If you'd ever seen my bottom at Stratford, you really wouldn't need to ask that.
Well, I did catch your bottom at Stratford, in fact.
You did? I gave my bottom opposite Peter Warner's snout, of course. I've also presented a crab in The Two Gentlemen of Verona in Bromley and Westcliff. That's Westcliff-on-Sea, of course, not the other Westcliff. If there is another one, which I doubt. Comedy is much more difficult, of course.
Why is that, I wonder?
Well, you probably didn't know this, but the essence of comedy is truth. If it isn't real, it can't be funny.
Can you give me an example of that?
If a pretend person is walking down the street and they slip on a pretend banana skin and fall down and pretend to fracture their pelvic girdle, it isn't funny. But if a real person is walking along and they slip on a real banana skin and really fracture their pelvic girdle, it is funny.
Is that right?
Oh, yes, very funny. Because it's true.
Is it?
Yes, absolutely true. Happened to my grandfather. I laughed for a week.
Well, Hugh, I'll let you get back to your work now. Thank you very much indeed.
Entirely your pleasure, Stephen. Bye.
Yes, aren't you forgetting something, Hugh?
I don't think so.
Good, good. I thought you might be, but you're not. Excellent. Now, let's, if we may, meet Emma Thompson. Emma, if I can just tear you away from the scene you're rehearsing there.
Okay, Barry, take five. I've counted how many there are in the box, so if you take more, I'll know.
Emma, hello.
Yes.
Emma, I suppose you're best known to the public for your portrayal of the neurotic, friendless madwoman who thinks she's a star. But really, you're just a wholesome girl next door, aren't you? I'm sorry, I got that wrong. You're best known as the wholesome girl next door, but really, you're just a neurotic, friendless madwoman who thinks she's a star, aren't you?
Yeah. I think the most extraordinary thing about me, Stephen, is that when I played Portia, you really believed that I was playing Portia. I even, and this is the truly frightening part, I even believed it myself. I truly believed I was playing Portia. I can't account for that.
Eerie. Emma, your list of accomplishments is startling. You write, you act, you sing, you dance, you play tragedy, comedy and magical realism. You're a well-regarded feminist and a political activist on behalf of a number of causes. How on earth do you find time to be a wife and mother?
I'm not a wife and mother.
I see. Well, ambitions?
I'd like to be a Taurian. At the moment I'm a Sagittarian. Taurians are more rounded.
Uh-huh. Hugh, would you like to come in here?
No, thanks. I'm happy where I am.
Right. Well, thanks to the pair of you. Well, we'll be hearing from Emma and Hugh later on in the programme. But now let's meet our studio audience. And this week it's Arnold from New Malden. Arnold, good evening.
Hello there, student.
Now, you're going to be our studio audience tonight. Mm-hmm. You'll be laughing at any humorous moments and joining in for a fair amount of the madcap revelry, I understand.
Very much hope so.
And what's your daytime job, I wonder?
I'm a bishop.
A bishop? What's that exactly?
Well, it can vary from denomination to denomination, but within the Anglican Communion, where I work, a bishop is what we call a diocesan leader. That means roughly that I am a sort of area chief, if you like. A diocese is a large region.
Oh, so you're quite senior, then?
Yes, I would say so. ecclesiastical hierarchies are as strictly defined as any.
And let's get this quite straight. This is within a church of some kind?
Yes. In my case, the Anglican Church. The Church of England.
Gotcha. So, you work in this Anglian church.
Anglican.
Right, this Anglican church. Mm. And that's what kind of work, principally? Is that manufacturing, or are you on the marketing side? PR, sales, what?
No, not really. It's administrative work, of course. But there's plenty of liturgical and canonical business as well. Baptism, confirmation, synodic work, Eucharists, the cure itself.
Whoa. Synodic, baptism, liturgical? It looks like there's rather a lot of jargon involved here. Is it good work, Arnold? Is it something you enjoy?
I hate it, Stephen. Always wanted to be a watercolorist, but I did geography at school, and that killed landscapes for me. Still, Episcopal duties keep me busy. No time for regrets.
I bet that's right, Arnold. I bet that's right. Well, all the more kind of you to take time off from your office to...
It's a palace, rather than an office.
Yeah, right. To take time off from your palace and to come and be our audience here tonight. Have you been an audience before?
Oh, yes. I have twice been the audience for Moneybox with Louise Botting and once for Janine McMullen's A Small Country Living.
Well, you know the form, then. Yeah. Right, if you'd like to go and sit down over there, we can begin. And as Walt Teufel's Skater's Waltz fades away, it's time, of course, for Spot the Funny Noise. You've played it before, you know the rules. I play two different sound effects. One of them is funny, one isn't. You have to use your skill and judgment to decide. Now here's sound effect number one. Was sound effect number one. Now for the second.
Antihistamine. Antihistamine.
And that was sound effect number two. Which one was funny? Or was neither? Answers on a postcode only. Now, to the film of E.M. Forster's remarkable novel, Devices and Desires. I went along to the opening with witch film critic Alexander Grise. But first, let's hear an extract. Margaret Freight is engaged to the effete Edward Lefanu. Unknown to him, she has had a liaison with Riffy, an Arab boy, during a holiday in Cairo. Here, Helen, the film's heroine, played by Christine Setti, is telling Timothy Sargent, her fiancé, played by Rupert Gardner, why she can't marry him, played by June Carney. The part of Dr. Ford, Simon Cracknell, Helen's stepfather, is played by Dinsdale Denham, Julian Raft. But first, played by Richard Esterhazy, she has to tell Aunt Jane, Joan Watson, played by Lydia Helm, the actress is Frances Watling, about her fears for her sanity, a rare appearance this by the veteran actress Jill Treacher, played by Juwinda Raines. Well, what's happening here? This is the scene where the family are in the art gallery and they're looking at the Mantegna canvas. It's beautifully photographed here. The camera's looking at the painting. You can hear the Mantegna theme on the oboe just there. Now the footsteps, you can hear, that's a group of German tourists who are just rushing by. They're not looking at the painting at all, which the family's... Now, we've cut to a flashback of the holiday on the Greek island of Paros. This is lovingly recreated at Shepperton Studios. There's Michael wrestling with Basil while Helen, is looking on. The fishermen are just... We've cut back to the art gallery. Jeff, is there a clip we can play with more dialogue in it? Thank you. That's it. Great. Now we're at the tea party at Mrs. Henslow's country house in Hertfordshire. And Aunt Jane is talking to Helen.
But Helen, it's all arranged. Some tea?
Arrangements?
You know I hate arrangements, Aunt Jane. I thought you at least understood.
Have you told him?
I'm going to have to be brave. So is he, but I've an awful feeling that inside he won't care.
Oh, how can you say that? Timothy is devoted to you, Ellen.
Oh, he's fond of me, all right. Just as he is fond of motor cars and John Buchan and almond cake. I will be added to the collection.
Well, is that so very dreadful, darling? Timothy has the finest collection of almond cake in the country. I know I should be honoured to be a part of it.
Miss Sandclove, Helen.
Timothy.
It's a trifle chilly. I think I'll just slip into the house and put some clothes on.
My love, look what I bought you.
Oh, Timothy.
I went to Grodzinski's yesterday and asked the man to bring out the best.
Timothy, it's lovely.
Will it fit on your finger?
Timothy, I'm not sure I want to wear a donut on my finger.
They don't do almond cakes in a ring. I thought this would please you. It cost enough.
Oh, Timothy, you can't weigh affection in pounds and pence. I wouldn't have cared if you had bought me nothing but a bap, so long as I felt you really cared.
A flowery bap or a plain bap?
Any kind of bap. That's not the point.
Jackson's of Piccadilly do a currenty bap.
I'm sure they do, Timothy. I'm sure they do a lovely currenty bap. Timothy, do you remember the Masaccio in the Prado?
What?
Florence, Timothy. Florence. There was a painting there in the Uffizi, a huge Modigliani. It spoke of...
It spoke?
To me it spoke, and to Aunt Jane, and I think to Dr. Ford. It spoke to us about the inner life and the outer life, Timothy, there in the Academia that week in Venice.
You mean that big canvas of the fat pink woman and the cherub?
It was a Madonna and child, yes, by Medina. It had a rhythm. Something happened in that stuffy room in the Rijksmuseum. A Spanish boy came up to me and whispered in my ear, do you remember?
And then you fainted. I had him thrown out.
There was a fussy English scene, shouting and blaming and shouting, blouting and shaming. But something had happened there in front of that Manet in the Louvre. Something had happened.
I'd say, you don't want me to buy the ruddy painting for you, do you? I'd have to sell half my collection of almond cakes to pay for a thing like that.
You don't need to buy it for me, Timothy. Every detail of that Matisse is all in my head. As if I were in the Hermitage in Leningrad, looking at it now, every brush stroke.
Sunstroke, more like.
The point is, you don't remember. That's the point. That's what the point is, don't you see? The point isn't something else. It's that. That's the point. Timothy, I hate it when you do that while I'm talking to you. It's rude and it isn't hygienic. Now, where was I? Yes, it was the point. That's the point. That painting, to you, it was just another Michelangelo. You never wanted to go with us to the Smithsonian and first place. I'm trying to say that I can't marry you.
Can't? Can't or won't?
Both. Neither. Oh, I don't know.
Ferdinand and Miranda in their brave new world. Do I intrude on the lovers?
Dr. Ford. No, I... We... That is, I... Who, she, that is... I...
Why was just leaving, Doctor? I'll take that cake box with me, won't I?
Helen, my child. What is it? You're laughing.
No, Doctor. I'm not laughing. I'm just sort of crying, that's all.
Well, what's so funny?
You remember the Spanish youth who whispered in my ear in the National Gallery?
Oh, vividly. We were looking at that superb Millet. I always wanted to know what the boy said to you. You never favoured me with the confidence.
He said...
Well, if you've read Devices and Desires, you'll know what he said. Otherwise, you can find out when the film opens in London tomorrow. Alexander Greyes. This is now the fourth Ivory Merchant film based on an E.M. Forster novel. Devices and Desires is probably, with the exception of Howard's End, the most difficult to adapt. Do you think it came off?
Well, I'd have to say that I rather think it did. I thought in particular the performance of Rupert Dean as the Spanish boy worked brilliantly. He was beautiful, he was smooth-limbed, he had deep brown eyes and a sort of puckish, boyish grin which revealed excellently white teeth. He wore simple cream shorts that exultantly emphasised rather than concealed his...
Yes. What about Dame Ulna Cruikshank as Aunt Jane? Did she bring it off?
I have to say that I think she was less successful. Her teeth are very yellowed. I think, in fact, they may be false. Rather low-slung breasts. They're real enough, I'm afraid. Her complexion, compared to Rupert Dean's extraordinary honey-tan smoothness, was humdrum, not to say unappealing. Dean had a kind of liquid grace about him in the way he moved, the way he flicked back a lock of that glossy young hair, the way those shorts rode up and...
Maria Castle as Helen, did that work?
Again, I couldn't detect the first provocative, downy suggestion of a moustache on her upper lip, as I could with Dean, and to some extent with Dame Ulner, of course. And she had rather full breasts, unlike Dean's taut, silky pectorals.
Well, I rather like those breasts.
Really? Well, they didn't work for me at all. Give me a supple, cultish frame.
So, Devices and Desires, starring Ulna Cruikshank, Daniel Masefield and Maria Castle.
And Rupert Dean.
And Rupert, as Alexander Greyes so rightly points out, Dean, is opening in the West End of London tomorrow.
Rupert Dean may want to get in touch with me to talk about his performance. I'm available on 01776 2.
In December 1986, during the fall of 1985, Dr. John Fordyce, working quietly on a serum to combat a deadly virus that was threatening to exterminate all London's estate agents and thus reduce house prices at a stroke, happened upon Floric-19, a remarkable semi-genetic plasma whose fantastic properties he only became aware of when he accidentally injected himself with an untested sample of the substance one balmy spring evening in the mid-60s in his laboratory in London's fashionable Edinburgh sometime during 1958.
Fordyce Lab Notes, Tape 7. Testing. I have injected 30 milligrams of Floric-19 into my thigh. So far, I feel no effects whatsoever. I can see clearly, think clearly. 77's a 49. The capital of Australia is Canberra. The Prime Minister of Great Britain is Margaret Thatcher. 12-12s are 144. No discernible contraindications whatever. Wait a minute. Something's happening to my chest. My flesh is expanding. The hairs on the back of my hand, they're disappearing.
Predictable as it seems, something was happening to Dr. John Fordyce.
My God. Something is happening to me. I've turned into a woman. There isn't any doubt about it. I have two unmistakable breasts and... Oh! I'm unquestionably a woman. 77's are 77. The capital of Australia is A. I'm even thinking differently, intuitively, freed from the shackles of logic and reason. I must note carefully the effects of this drug. But first, I have so many thank you letters to catch up on. I never wrote to Andre and Judith thanking them for that dinner party in 77. Dear Judy, just a brief note...
And so, Jenny Flamisto was born. But back in Belgravia's fashionable London, over the months, Dr. Fordyce learned to control the drug, whose effects would wear off after 3 hours, transforming him back from Jenny Flamisto to hard-working John Fordyce. But his alter ego, Jenny, was no ordinary woman.
When I am Jenny, and this must be some strange property of Floric-19, I have extraordinary powers. If I half-close my eyes and stare very hard, I'm able to understand and appreciate a lot of modern art that I used to consider rubbish. My movements are much more regular than I have any right to expect, and I seem to have no trouble at all programming the video correctly. Oh, and I can fly, make myself invisible, throw my voice, and see through things.
With these extraordinary powers, Fordyce, as Jenny, was able to use her gifts to create a massive fortune for herself, carving out a criminal empire that stretched from one place to another one quite a long way away from it. One man knew of her secret, American-born radio announcer Don McElwain, and he, using stolen tape recordings of Fordyce's original experiment, planned to expose Jenny Flamisto for what she was on national radio. But even while he was broadcasting, Jenny Flamisto burst into the small studio in London's central London and confronted the one man who stood between her and her crazed ambitions.
So, Don McElwain, you dare to expose me?
We're on air, she-wolf. Anything you say will be broadcast to literally people.
You fool. Hmm? You puny fool. You feeble fool. You feeble, puny fool. You foony, peeble fool. You fooly, phenal pube. With one thought, I can hypnotize a whole audience into thinking that they are listening to whatever I choose. Even as we speak, they think they are listening to...
The streets of Cabo Damble bustle with life as early as 6 o'clock in the morning as the bright dews that sweep down from the bashed mountains drape themselves around the tall, mud-daubed buildings of the old colonial residence, a piquant reminder of the all-but-forgotten days of British rule. Emmerich Lurgin, grateful for the weekly opportunity to talk in pseudo-literary journalese, Cabo Damble.
That report from Roger Dorton in Hyannisgull ends this edition of From Our Own Correspondent.
And From Our Own Correspondent was produced in our Bristol studios by Haranita Dench. And now, before the news and weather, here is the shipping forecast issued by the Meteorological Office at 1400 hours Greenwich Mean Time. Finisterre, Dogger, Rockall, Bailey, no. Wednesday, variable, imminent, super. South at Cira, North at Cira, Sheerness, Foulness, Elliotness. If you will, often, imminent, 447, 22 yards, touchdown, stupidly. Malin, Hebrides, Shetland, Jersey, Fair Isle, Turtleneck, Tank Top, Cortell, blowy, quite misty, seasickness. Not many fish around, come home, veering suggestively. That was the shipping forecast for 0700 hours, Wednesday the 18th of August. And now here is an urgent message for a Mr. Timothy Wilton of Hemel Hempstead. Will Mr. Timothy Wilton, last believed to be on a bicycling holiday in Beaconsfield, please return home immediately, where his mother is seriously annoyed about how untidy his bedroom is.
You see? They can hear nothing but normal radio output. Your plan has failed, Dom McElwain.
Wrong, Jenny Flamisto. They're listening to us now.
What? How did you... No one could have interfered with my broadcast projection like that. No one. Unless...
Unless they had taken Fluoric 19 too? Yes. You've met your match, Jenny Flamisto. Meet...
Barry Cryer.
But you... That is,
following the instructions on your lab tapes, I formulated the serum and injected myself with it.
Aye, that is, you... I never think...
Instead of turning into a woman, I turned into Barry Cryer. I may have left out some vital ingredient, but don't underestimate me. I am packed with strange powers. Amongst my supernatural gifts, I have the remarkable ability to find something suggestive and naughty in anything you say.
But that's extraordinary.
Extraordinary? At my age, it's a miracle.
But it's horrifying.
It is horrifying, isn't it? I'll put it away. There, you see what I mean? A lewd ambiguity for every occasion.
You're having me on.
No, but it's an idea.
You can keep this up indefinitely.
Are you sure you want me to answer that?
All right, if you can twist any remark I might make, try this. Buttercup.
Buttercup, buttock down. Buttercup, buttock down. And rest. Thank you, madam.
Curses, that was too easy. I'll try another. Anti-tank missile.
You flatter me, but you should see it when it's angry.
I don't get it.
I'll soon put a stop to that.
My God, you have actually become Barry Cryer. Your double entendres are staggering.
Only when I cough.
Well, if you really are Barry Cryer, would you mind signing this? It's for my children.
I don't remember ordering any children.
I can have them biked over to you tomorrow. The youngest is allergic to eggs. Apart from that, there should be no trouble. Please sign for them. There's a dotted line on the bottom there.
There's a novelty.
Well, quite.
And as Saint-Saëns' organ concerto fades away, we come to that part of the programme in which we copy, rather shamelessly, but with deep respect, an idea which has been seen on your television screens as Jim'll Fix It. We call it Stephen Will Do His Level Best to Comply with Your Wishes. And our first letter comes from Michael Thompson, aged 7. Dear Stephen, please would you do your level best to comply with my wish to go up in a hot air balloon? No. Now, a letter here from... Rebecca Taylor? Oh, this is the most atrocious handwriting. I'm not doing my level best to comply with any wish from this one here. Now, what are they teaching them these days? Onward and upward. Here's one from Yasmin Schofield, age 12. Dear Stephen, please can you do your level best to comply with my wish for there to be world peace and no more hungry people in the world? Well, as a matter of fact, I can, Yasmin, yes, but I don't think we'd make very good radio, do you? Now... Dear Stephen, please, 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 yes, 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 yes. Please, 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 could you do your level best to comply with my wish to interview David Bowie from Jackie Fry, aged 12. P.S. I think your program's great, Uncle Stephen. Right. Well, we'll do our level best for you, Jackie, and this is what happened.
Jackie and I are standing outside David Bowie's London pied-à-terre. I wonder if he's in. What do you think, Jackie?
Don't know.
Well, we'll know soon enough. You excited, Jackie?
Yes.
Oh, it's him.
Jimmy?
Hello, David. It's Stephen Fry here from Saturday Night Fry. I have a young friend with me, and we were wondering... That's Fry, and we were wondering... F-R-Y.
Yeah.
That's right. We were wondering if we might come in, listen to some of your discs, and have a little chat.
Well, no. I think
well, when will he be back?
Well, about 7 months,
Well, can we come in and wait for him, do you think?
Well, it's all right.
Oh, I see. Well, where would you suggest we go?
Frank Train for Lauren.
Mm-hmm. Well, I hardly think we'll find Mr. Barry there, attractive though the thought may be. Hello? Hello? Oh. Well, so, anyway, Jackie, that was the actual outside of David Bowie's flat. On to the next stage of our complying with your wishes. I think a visit to a real pop music recording studio is in order. Can we come in and wait?
No.
I see.
Our next stop was Hammersmith and the Metropolitan Police car pound for an absorbing afternoon spent searching for my car.
What? But this is absurd. I was recording a radio programme.
£45.
Oh, very well. Jackie, have you got £5? Jackie? Right.
The next port of call was Great Ormond Street Hospital for sick children.
Hello, Jackie. I brought you some grapes.
Now, it was very silly of you to run away, wasn't it, Jackie? Especially as I've got a car. You know you didn't stand a chance. Never mind. I've brought along a rather special visitor for you.
Yes, it's Hugh.
Hello.
Did you go to that film in the end, Hugh?
Yes, I did, yeah.
Well, after all that, we invited Jackie to come and join us in the studio today. But she refused. Which was very stupid of her, because sitting next to me right now is David Bowie. Hello.
Hello.
So, up yours, Jackie, with a wire brush. And now, my final letter. Dear Stephen, can you do your level best to comply with my wish to appear in the next item with you? Yours in a fever of anticipation, Hugh Laurie. Oh, really, Hugh, I would have hoped that you thought you knew me well enough not to need to ask that. The answer, in fact, is no, because we're going straight away now over to Professor Florian Bilney of the School of Anglo-Velvic Studies with the third of his...
You see, Don McElwain or Barry Cryer or whatever you call yourself, your powers are fading. They are all listening to normal radio output again.
Don't be too sure, Jenny Flamisto. One more sip of Floric 19... and I can turn myself into...
Neville Sanderson.
What? But who? But how? But him? But...
Yes, exactly. In Neville Sanderson, you have met your final adversary, Jenny Flamisto. For I can turn you into an advertising voiceover.
Never. You wouldn't dare. You know, but which gave me...
Because you're lovely, Fevlon have created Spring Mist, a new kind of fragrance for a new kind of woman.
You see? And how about this?
Now, there is a lavatory cleanser that goes clear to the pain. New double-action floosh. First, a decongestant to soothe and disinfect. Then, a new kind of freshener that goes on working. All the fat, half the taste. That's the floosh promise.
Alexander Grise, if I can turn to you, people seem to be turning into people rather a lot. Does it come off as a piece of radio theatre, do you think?
Well, I could only wish that someone would turn into Rupert Dean.
Yes, turning to our audience now, Bishop Arnold, reactions, thoughts, inferences?
Stephen, I wonder if you'll do your level best to comply with my wish to be allowed to read this piece of paper here.
Oh, fire away, Bish.
You've been listening to Saturday Night Fry, written and presented by Stephen Fry, starring Hugh Laurie and Emma Thompson. Tonight's guest stars were Barry Cryer and David Bowie. Additional material by Ian Brown and James Henry. The show was produced by Dan Patterson. Stephen, could you do your level best to comply with my wish to get Rupert Dean to read that? I think it would particularly suit his honey-toned, velvet-throated, sweet and youthful voice.
No, I'm sorry. Time, the old enemy, has vanquished us once more, but don't forget to join us when we serve up another skillet full of breadcrumb surprises in next week's Soda of Saturday Night Fry.
Now, if you ever want to get a fist in your eye, just mention a Saturday Night Fish Fry. I don't care how many fish in the sea, but don't ever mention a fish to me. It was rocking, it was rocking. You never see that stuffing and shuffling till the break of dawn. It was rocking. Scuffing and shuffling till the break of dawn.